Oh, come on. You good now?
Good morning, bird brains, and welcome back to the episode of Gone Country. I believe it's episode 3. Today, we're gonna not only cut some trails, but I'm gonna show you guys what I use and how I do it. Let's get into it. Good morning, Bob. How are you doing today? Damn it. I forgot my cooler. Did you hide Dad's cooler? Was it you? You might be wondering, what the hell's on your feet? These are the Gonex snake gaiters that allow me to kind of just trample through all the deep grass and everything without having to worry about getting bit by a snake and dying. So that's $40-$45 well spent on these. Thankfully, I haven't had to use them yet, but I've come pretty close. All right, Bob. Now we can get to work. So first off, I'm gonna go ahead and apologize if my energy seems a little bit down. Just notice I'm wearing the same shirt as last time. Got a different hat though, because the sun's out. I'm a little upset because I don't like when people make their f-ups my f-ups. Long story short, I went into a tractor rental place last week, last Friday. Today is Saturday, so it's been 8 days. And I said, I need a tractor, trailer, a shredder, and a loader. They said, no problem, got you for this amount of money, you can pick it up at this time. Cool. They called me 2 hours before I'm supposed to pick it up. And they're like,
just want to make sure you were still coming to pick up the tractor and trailer.
And I said, yeah, I'm going to be there in about 2 hours.
Yeah, the problem is that, were you still going to need the trailer?
I don't have a trailer that is big enough to hold that, so yeah, I'm going to need the trailer.
Oh, okay, well, the problem is that we didn't get the trailer back from the other rental, so, do you have access to a trailer?
If I had access to a trailer, why would I be paying you guys to rent the trailer?
Okay, well, we can let you know if something comes up. Hello, sir, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm at a loss for words I guess there's nothing that I can really do to fix this situation.
Yeah, have a good weekend.
I won't. That's literally how the conversation went. He just said, have a good weekend. He didn't offer any remedies to the situation or offer me a discount for next weekend, nothing. So I said, you guys, you're not getting my dollar. But the problem is that I was relying on that trailer to clear all of this. So essentially, I've got about 2 acres-ish. This is the pit bike track behind me that needs a desperate shredding. The reason for that is because I'm planning on using this as like an RV/parking spot area for the people coming for the trail cutting party in like 2 weeks. So this was literally my second to last weekend I could have done this, and now I'm just kind of shit of luck. I called a couple places and they're either rented out or they don't offer that equipment. Apparently the equipment I'm looking for is very uncommon for renting, because most people just buy it and have it, which I would love to just buy it and have it, but they're like $30,000, and I don't have $30,000 laying around, despite what you guys think how YouTube money works. Nothing I can do about that, so we're gonna go ahead and head out to where the trails are ending at currently, and kind of show you the process behind that, and you guys can just hang out with me on a day of trail cutting. We're out here, guys. We're on the backside of the boneyard. And if you watched last episode, you heard me say about how the boneyard's kind of the central area to the trail system. It's kind of weave back and forth through there a couple times. We're gonna do most of those weaves today on today's episode. So this location right here is where I ended the trails yesterday. And that is what we have to go through today. What you see behind me, that's basically how the trails look after I've gone through and cut them. So let's go ahead and I'll take you guys back here and kind of show you what I've done so far.
So this is what the, I call it the soft cut. This isn't the actual cutting of the trails. This is more of just so I can get through, and then when the crew comes in, they can get through. But that's essentially what it looks like when you start, and then that is what it looks like when you're finished. Also, you see all these roots and stuff with the orange paint. That is what one thing that we'll be doing is removing all of these come actual trail cutting time. How I mark the trails is with this orange ribbon. I just do one on each side of the trail, kind of showing like you have to go through these. So I've got one right there, one right there. The reason I have this tape going across here is because if we step over here, this is actually same trail system, but just different trail. So you'll come in this way and you'll be going down that way. And if we step over to the side here, that's actually the creek down there. So we're about 10, 15 feet up from the creek. And this is where the loop will be running. Like I said, there'll be spots where it's coming up from the creek and then down into the creek. But for now, we're just cutting the upper trail system. So it goes that way, goes way back over the road, comes back around, and now it's coming through right here. So I'm not gonna show you guys any raw footage of me actually cutting trails, because talk about a snooze fest. I'm gonna do cool time lapses and stuff so you see just like a whole blown, at least I'm hoping it looks cool. I've never done this before, but I kind of want to show you guys some of my equipment and what I carry and how I get these trails cut. Alright, so first things first, let's talk about the attire. Now obviously I'm wearing this nice bright colored shirt that I got from your mom's closet. This is a Magellan Outdoors, so it's got the SPF 30 or SPF 50 built into it. It's moisture wicking, so moisture wicking I found out here where it's very humid. I mean, it's not on the coast humid, but it's way more humid than it is even an hour west in San Antonio, is moisture wicking is the key. So I've got moisture wicking pants, moisture wicking socks, moisture wicking shirt. On my head, I got my sun hat. I wear this when it's sunny outside. If it's not sunny, I'll wear my regular Vikenberg hat that you see. I showed you guys my snake gaiters. These, this just kind of allows you to not focus so much on, okay, like where am I stepping every single step, and allows you to focus more on what you're actually doing. On my tool belt, I got a Gerber multi-tool. It's got, I mean, everything around the planet, pliers, knife. This one even has like a screwdriver and all that kind of stuff. Got my Texas flag, Cobra Tech automatic knife. That's a must have out here. And then of course I have my Springfield Arms XD40. That is for all the copperheads I was mentioning in the last episode as well. And then after I am dressed, I go ahead and get my tool belt out here. This is just a very standard $20 tool belt off of Amazon, but it is a lifesaver out here cutting trails. I've also noticed that if I put it above my gun and above my multi-tool, it kind of rests on my actual belt as opposed to the cheapo buckle on there. So there's a little pro tip for you. Over my left side, I've got a Gerber machete. This was actually a gift from Get Lowered Cycles, believe it or not. They send me a little gift every year to kind of thank me for the partnership and things like that. And this thing has been an absolute workhorse out here. Got two cans of spray paint. I got one for the vertical surfaces and then one for the horizontal spray. And that allows me to mark stuff that needs to be taken out, shaven down, made not so pointy, so it's a little bit safer for the riders. And then in this pocket I have my marking tape, which is very convenient because I can just pull and it just unravels itself. I don't actually have to have it on a spool or anything. And then in this pocket I have a golf ball from yesterday. I don't know why, but I'm finding golf balls all over the place out here. Like, not even joking, this was just from yesterday. And then I've got a couple more up there and things like that.
It's funny because like you'll be like way out in the middle of nowhere and you're just like trudging through forest or the woods and cutting shit down. Heavy shit! And I'm thinking like, man, I might be the first human being to ever step foot. And then I freaking find a Callaway One, big Bertha. Anyways, back to the tools. Last but not least, I have my Fiskars Power Gear 2 loppers. Guys, if you do any sort of tree trimming, get you these loppers. They're only like, I think 30, 40 bucks. I got it at Home Depot, and they've got this little gear system that really allows you to just, I mean, really just clamp down on shit. If it fits in the jaws, it's cutting it. I mean, simple as that. So I do most, I'd say 90% of the trail cutting with just those tools I showed you. I also have the Still gas-powered weed eater. I also have a brush blade attachment to go onto that in case I get into some thicker stuff. This has been useful, but I find it kind of creates more work than it saves because you end up just chopping it into a bunch more pieces and makes it hard to take out. And then, of course, I got a pole saw up there for the taller stuff. I don't use that much on this part of the trail cutting. And then down here, I have the Echo, I think it's the FS490 20-inch chainsaw that we use for the bigger, harder stuff, which I took a quick look through here, and it looks like we are going to get to use that here in this section, so that's always fun. So, yeah, let me get gloved up and everything, and I'll kind of show you how I tackle sections of trail like this. Okay, so the plan is to come out of here, come across here, cut across the fire road, and go right in here. Now, it's very easy to see on camera. I've got a big tree right here and a big tree right there. I'm gonna make those my waypoints, which means that's where my tape is gonna be on. So basically, anything between those trees, I'm going to cut down at least to this level to where when we come back through with the larger crew, we can get those at that time. So the easiest way that I've found to do this is to focus on little batches at a time. So I don't know how hard this is to see with all the shadows, but I've got this little group of trees here. I don't know what kind of trees these are. If you know what kind of trees these are, let me know down in the comments, because this is what is like 90% of the trees on my property. And they're a bitch because they sprout a lot of branches, as you can see. I mean, it's kind of just a mess in here. So basically what I'll do is I'll take the machete and I'll try to shave off as many of these weird spare branches as I can. So like, I'll take that stuff off. I'll take that stuff off. Sorry, I'm working with one hand, so this is a little difficult. But you can kind of see already how much just those couple strokes cleaned up that branch. And I'll basically do that to this whole bundle of trees. All right, so I went ahead and cleared off most of the extra branches from here on this little bundle, and you can see it cleans it up quite a bit. I still have some up top, but that's fine. I pretty much just try to get the stuff that I can reach, because when you get to the stuff that the tree's so thin, it's really hard to cut everything off. And then from there, I'll actually come back with the loppers and chop them at about knee height. There you have it. And from there, it's basically just rinse and repeat a lot. And then when you come back through, I usually do this at the end, but for video purposes, I'll just come in here and give a quick little spray here, make it visible for the next crew that comes through. And the reason I leave them knee height is because I want to get a lot of the roots out when we pull them. So leaving them knee height allows you to get some leverage on the actual tree after the ground has been dug up a little bit. Makes it a lot easier to actually take them out. All right, so now that you guys have seen the nitty gritty behind it, let's go ahead and blast a hole through here and let's get into the boneyard. There's one section done.
Had to take a break because that was only about an hour's worth of work, but it's 11:30 and it's already 90 degrees and 72% humidity, so it's already pretty miserable.
Well, let's take a look at what we got here. So here's the trail coming into it, and then boom, there's our nice big hole. And I don't know how well it shows up on camera, but this drops about 6 to 8 feet down here, down this hill right here. And this is where I stopped at. This is where you can see me putting the wood over on this side. Oh yeah, let me take you back up the hill here. Oh God. So you can see, you saw me kept stepping off camera. I wanted to show you the discard pile over here. When you're working in an area next to one of the fire roads here, it's very easy to make a discard pile because you got this big open road right here. But when you're back in the thick, man, not having a big open area like this makes it very difficult. But here's all the material that we just removed. Now granted, some of this is from yesterday on the other side, but kind of get an idea of how big some of these trees are. I'm 6'2", and these are easily double my height, so they're at least 12, 15 feet up there. They're not super heavy, but all the stuff on the end of them, having to pull them through the rest of the canopy, it's pretty tough work. So if we go back through the trail, I don't know if you ever heard the term that everything in Texas will either bite you, burn you, sting you, or stick you. These vines are the epitome of that. Let's see if I can get a close up here so you can see. Let's look at this one. You can see how prickly and spiny these things are. And they will go right through your clothes, right through your gloves. They don't give a damn. What's really bad is when they get wrapped around your leg like that. And then you just kind of pull on them. If they're on the snake gators, okay, they don't go through that, but if they get anywhere above that, pretty painful. Anyways, here is what we have come up to on the trail. I'm thinking go up right here and then down across, but let me go kind of scout this out real quick. Now you can see why I need the gators here. All right, so here's the boneyard, and my plan is I want to come around this little berm, or not a berm, but this little buildup area right here. As you can see back through here, that's our trail currently. Ideally, I would like to just shoot it right across here, but I really don't want to take those trees down because I had to take out quite a bit back there. And I think I'm going to have it come down here, maybe come to the right of these or the left of these, and then come through right here, come around here. We'll take out these right here. I'll leave that big one, come around here, and then zoom back around here. The reason I wanted to come through here is because this mound right here is shaped in a nice little takeoff jump. It's prime for it. I don't know how well it shows up on camera, but this surface right here is just asking to be launched. So I'm thinking of making this the launch, have this little mound be the landing. I'll take down a good chunk of that. So basically, you'll come around this pile, go up in between this tree and that tree, go back onto that landing, loop around those banks of trees up there. I have to do it tight because I already have trails back up there. And then come down here, launch, land, into a quick right, and then I'll start making my way back through that part of the jungle. So I guess the good news is that with breaking into the open here, I'll be able to get a lot of distance without a ton of cutting through the thick stuff. But the bad part is I'm right back into the thick of it afterwards. So back to the time lapse.
It's now 2:45. Temperature is up to 92, but feels like 102, the real feel. Got it quite a bit done. Let me go show you what we've gotten done so far.
So this is the progress that we've made so far, but I wanted to show you this tree here. These trees are all over the property, and not this specific type, but I'm just talking about ones that are so dead and decrepit and just downright dangerous. So I did go around this one, but I think this one's gonna have to come down, because if you listen, it is extremely hollow, and I did this earlier. Just with the twist of my wrist, I'm moving over half the tree just by twisting my wrist here. So probably gonna have to cut down this bad boy, because that's just too dangerous to have that close to the trail. But we've made it back here probably, 100-ish feet. And I found this as well, Hershey's syrup container. And you can see the, looks like the coon's got a hold of it. I think it's expired. I don't know. I've also found two more golf balls on this little section here too, so add that to the collection. I think the plan here is to start turning left. The fire road is actually running right back there, probably about another 150 to 100 feet. So I'm gonna take a left here and kind of hug this road until we get to, there's a clearing back here. I don't know if it was like an old double check that the previous hunters had, but oh look, there's a golf ball right there too. Let me see if I can zoom in on it. Oh yeah, you can see it on the camera. I don't get it, man, but I mean, there you go. No, I'm not making it up. But anyways, there's a another clearing that runs back through here, so I'm gonna take advantage of that and kind of cut left till we hit that, and then cut back, and that should be the last time we cross into the boneyard from here. This is my shirt. I just want to show you guys how hot it is exactly. Don't know if I'm able to do this with one hand here, but that's how hot it is.
Hey guys, Future Justin here. I was gonna do a Q&A while out cutting the trails, but as you'll see at the end of the video, that didn't work, so I'm cutting in now. There were a couple repeat questions, but I'll go ahead and kind of address those. Wolf Jewelry Co. asked, how long is it gonna take for you to be at a comfortable spot with it? That is a great question, because I have no idea. So originally we were gonna be hopefully moved into our new house on, I wanna say the first week of August, but that looks like that's not gonna happen. How can I say this nicely? When you go in to purchase a manufactured home or a mobile home, the price that you see is not the price of what you pay. It's kind of like a car, you know, you got your sticker price, then they tag on the delivery fee and the assembly fee and all that nonsense, but just way worse because it's a house. The total cost of the house we're looking at is about 25 grand off of what we thought it was going to be. So we're kind of having to start over on the whole house search, which kind of sucks, but it is what it is. But I'm hoping by the end of 2021, we're at least somewhat settled. I feel like that's as close as I can get it realistically. There's still so many unforeseen things that we're gonna have to kind of tackle that's the best get. That's the best guess I have at this point. Maddie Roadster, I can't see the number. I don't like how Instagram does this. It doesn't allow you to see the full name. It just kind of does like a dot, 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 and there's no way you can kind of click into it to see it. But anyways, Maddie Roadster, one something, you know who you are. How many trees you got to clear? No idea. A lot. I guarantee you I've cut down at least 200. And I'm not talking about like trees, but, you know, they're that big around, but I guess it's a tree. A lot is the answer. This is one that was asked kind of the same, kind of in a couple different forms. Wapow, it's Dan, that's all I can see. The Real Fat Man, ZK21, and NightRap73. Y'all's names are awesome. They asked, is there going to be a dirt bike track? Is there going to be trails? How many trails? Is there going to be enough room to ride a dirt bike on? So as you see in the other videos, yes, we are putting in a trail system. I don't know how long it is yet. I've worked a couple days since I filmed the first part of this video, and I'm getting really close to being finished. I would say one or two more days, minus the trail sections going into and out of the creek. I don't know how long those are going to take. I'm estimating, and I have to throw out a wide estimate because this is literally just a complete guess. I have no data to back this up. I'm guessing between 2 and 3 miles. My goal was to be between 3 and 4. I don't think I'm going to hit that just because of the size of the land, the restrictions I'm under. I probably could, but I don't want to make trails that are just so tight and technical that they're not even fun. I want more flowy, fast trails. Yeah, hopefully we hit that 3 mark. I'll let y'all know probably by episode 4 or episode 5 for sure. N77COF asked, how big is it? It's 10 acres. It's 10.032 acres to be exact. This next one was also another one that was asked in a couple different ways. BigUgly84 asked, shooting range? 22Moto asked, enough land to play with pew-pews? Uncle Ken asked, what is your gun range distance? Justin Shinona asked, where's the hunting stand going? So basically everyone wants to know about guns and everything. So in Texas, if you have private land over 10 acres, you are able to shoot and hunt on that land. I don't have any intentions on hunting. It's just not my thing. I don't have anything against it. If you do it, more power to you. I think it's a great way, especially with conservation. That's the word I'm looking for. Especially when it's done with conservation in mind. I think it's really beneficial to the ecosystem and the environment. So all for it. It doesn't interest me. Just flat out doesn't interest me. I will say I've seen a deer since I've been here. Just one. So probably not the best hunting land. I know that's going to sound dumb, disappointingly, but I haven't seen any evidence of hogs or wild pigs out here. I was expecting to see a lot of it because we're so close to a creek and just this area is really known for it. Nothing so far. So maybe we got lucky and don't have them, but not much hunting to do. But as far as the gun range goes, I don't have a specific location set out for it. The previous owner of the property did have a little target station set up, but you're only looking at probably 30 to 40 yards, so nothing huge. If I was wanting to set up a long range, I could probably, it would take some work, but I could probably get a 200 yard range out here somewhere. But no immediate plans to do that. I don't have any long rifles or anything like that, so most of the shooting I do is all pistols anyways, so that small range that we have set up now is probably going to be good enough, but it's definitely lower down on the priority list. Caleb Patrone asked, will you make a fish/alligator pond? Well, I don't like alligators. I don't like crocodiles, so definitely won't be putting in those, but we don't really have the size and the area to put in a pond that will be worthwhile. We have that creek down there at the bottom, but it doesn't run. Pretty much my neighbor on this side, my neighbor on that side, both have really good sized fishing ponds. So hopefully I can make friends with them and go fish in their pond. But no plans to put any sort of water features on the property. W. Goostein 92, he's the pro rider at Torx that I go and train with every now and then. He asked, when is the invite to come ride going to happen? Hopefully soon. Hopefully we get the trail system completely finished during my birthday weekend, which is the last weekend in July. And after that, I will have ride days pretty regularly after that. I don't like to ride alone. I think it gets boring real fast. So I'm hoping to have a constant group of guys out here. And I'm hoping that this trail system is big enough to where it doesn't get boring fast. That's another one of my goals, is to make it interesting enough to where you don't get bored with it quick. Uncle Ken also asked, do I have a burn barrel? Yes, I do. It's actually out behind this house in the little backyard area. Haven't burned anything in it yet, but it's there and it's ready to go. Ace Beer Ranch asked, is it the same as in my dream? A little backstory. He had a dream that he came and rode the property before I even had cut a single trail. So he actually hasn't even seen the property yet. So I'm like, that's weird that you had a dream about a place that you haven't been to. But I guess he'll have to come out and see because I don't know what his dream looked like. Art745 asked, what part of town? So it's about an hour. It's 52 miles east of San Antonio. It's pretty much smack dab in the middle between Luling and Seguin. Really close to the interstate, actually. It's only about a mile north of the interstate. If you've ever taken Interstate 10 between Houston and San Antonio, they have that big giant way station just east of Seguin. It's pretty close to that. Viking on Two Wheels asked a really cool question. He said, is the property going to be an open space type, or do you leave a lot of trees? So it's funny that he asked that because the neighbor to our left, he has, I want to say, 12 to 15 acres, and he cleared out like 95% of it. He pretty much only left the big oak trees, and it looks really good. But to have that done is ridiculously expensive. Plus, I like to ride trails that feel like trails. I don't like riding just open property. So the front section of the property has already been mostly cleared. That's where you saw me do the pit bike track. That is probably about the most open it's going to get. We bought this property specifically for the trees. We liked how secluded and everything it felt. So probably going to leave most of the trees. There's no plans on taking a lot of trees down for now. Pretty much the only trees we'll be cutting down is the stuff that we need to cut down to get the new home and the new spot for the garage in. So I had another one come in through Facebook. I somehow lost it. I don't know how to check an archive of my story on Facebook. But it was by, the question was from Philip, who is the owner of San Marcos Motorcycles. He asked if I had any armadillos. I know he asked some other questions, but that's the one that stuck out to me. So I've seen a lot of evidence of armadillos around the property, but I've only seen one. But that one is special. I went ahead and named him Freddy. He scared the crap out of me because I've only seen him once, but I swear this is the biggest armadillo I have ever seen in my life. Around, he was probably about this big around. I mean, here's my head, definitely bigger around than my head. I mean, this dude was like, he looked like a brownish gray bowling ball kind of rolling through the weeds. Absolutely ginormous. But I would assume just based off of the amount of holes and stuff I found, he's definitely not the only one. Probably one of the most prevalent animals out on this property. All right, guys, well, that's all the questions. Thank you for all that submitted a question. Now, back to past Justin when he was about to die of heat stroke.
All right, guys, I'm tapping out. I'm starting to get dehydrated, and I can't put down fluids fast enough to keep it up, so I'm gonna have to call it a day. Wish I would have gotten about an hour more, but it is what it is. I still have plenty of days to get it done. I'm not stressing just yet. Well, guys, I hope you enjoyed this one. I know it was a little bit more hands-on than we have previously. Let me know down in the comments, do you like these better, or do you like kind of the updates and catch-ups better? I kind of enjoyed Wow, I can't think straight. I might be more dehydrated than I thought. I kind of enjoyed making the video because it kind of kept me a little bit more organized and on task. So I don't mind making them, guys. So if you want to see more of these, let me know down in the comments. If you like this video, yeah, guys, that's it for today's video. I got to go get in some AC and take a nice cool shower because I'm feeling it. If you like this video, go ahead and hit that like button. If you haven't already, go ahead and punch that subscribe button. And as always, thank you for watching. I'll see you guys next time.